Let's take a look at estimating the cost for a concrete pad. So common uses of concrete are foundations, footings, driveways, sidewalks, floors, retaining walls, piers, columns. So you're going to want to add these to a blank Google Doc that you can add into your notes. This picture here is actually of my house in Alaska, and we have the house framed up here. This is going to be a our garage floor here, and so we have insulation, styrofoam insulation underneath it, just to keep it a little bit warmer on the inside of that garage. And then there's rebar in here, which we'll talk about as well. So rebar, reinforcing bar, is great for concrete because concrete is high compression strength as you squeeze it together, but really poor tensile strength. It can pull apart rather easily or shear rather easily. So rebar is added to increase the tensile strength, and that is reinforcing bar. So again, this is another picture of my building site when we built up in Alaska. Rebar is also used to pin one structural element to an adjacent one. So if we have a footing down here and we want to connect to a footing way up here, then we would use rebar and bend it down to kind of tie these in together. So that helps tie the concrete together. So what we're going to do in this project is to determine how much our concrete is going to cost. Concrete is always sold by volume and measured in cubic yards. So cubic yards, 3 feet by 3 feet by 3 feet deep. That's how much you would, that's the number you would use when you're buying concrete. So if you're going to figure out or estimate the cost of a pad, if your pad size is 18 feet by, or 16 feet by 18 feet, and you want 4 inches thick, the first thing you need to do is convert all units into feet. So this might be a good picture, actually a good slide to screenshot and add to your notes, because it shows really all the steps that you need to do when you do this on your project. Then we're going to calculate the volume, length by width by thickness, and get the total number of cubic feet. Last, we convert cubic feet into cubic yards. And if there's 3 feet in 1 yard, 3 cubed is 27 cubic feet in 1 cubic yard. So then we multiply 96 cubic feet by our conversion factor, which is a cubic yard over 27 cubic feet, and we get 3.55 cubic yards. You never round down. If it's 3.1 yards, then you have to go to round up to the nearest half yard, because you can't be short. That's a really, really bad idea, because you have to order usually minimums of maybe 4 cubic yards. So if you're short by just a small amount, you need to get 4 cubic yards of concrete additional every load, and then you got to figure out where you're going to put it. So if it's 3.55, you'd say 4 cubic yards. If it's 3.2, then you might say 3.5 cubic yards. So you could estimate to the nearest half yard. Concrete is typically, again, sold in increments of a half yard. So if it's $98 a cubic yard, for example, then it would be $392 total. Now this is a little bit low price. Right now it's going to be a little bit more than that. And I have price estimates on the assignment. So if you're going to estimate the cost of a pad, then you need to also calculate the number of rebar that you need. So what we did in that prior example was calculate the amount of concrete and the cost for concrete. So rebar is placed every 2 feet on a grid. It's sold in 10-foot lengths, and it must be lapped 6 inches to maintain strength. So you can see we have one stick here, there's a 6-inch overlap that you will actually tie together with pieces of wire. And as those things are next to each other and sunken deep into concrete, they sort of act as one continuous piece. You also need to maintain 3 inches edge distance. So we have this bar 3 inches away from the outside edge on this side, 3 inches away from the outside edge on this side. So if it's 18 feet, we have a 10-foot bar and an 8-foot bar. We have 6 inches overlap, and we get that 6 inches from the 3 inches that we had to slide in from this side and the 3 inches that we had to slide in from this side. And that's what gives us our 6-inch overlap. So if you're going to calculate the total number of rebar that you need, you're going to need to have 10-foot sticks. We need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 over on this side. And then we need, for full length sticks, we need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 going vertically. So we have 9 going this direction and 10 going vertically. So that's 19 10-foot sticks. Now to overlap these are only, if we have a 16 foot wide, 10 feet and 6 feet give you 16 feet. If you have 3 inches open on each edge and then a 6 inch overlap. So we need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 6 foot bars, so that's where we get this. And our 8 foot bars are these remaining sections. These ones here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So 9 8-foot bars. So in total, we have 19, 9, and 10. If it's sold in 10-foot lengths, then you need 38 total 10-foot pieces of rebar. And you're going to have a lot of scrap, and that's just the way that it goes. There are always ways that you can apply different things, different uses for these scraps as well. So we have to figure out the cost for all the rebar. If each piece of number four represents the thickness, the diameter of the rebar. If each piece costs $4.78 and we have 38 of them, then we have a total cost of $181. Plus the concrete gives us $573.64. Now there's other materials that you're going to actually calculate, which are forms that you're going to use. And the forms, you would put a board on each side to make a border so that the concrete doesn't just spill out. And so if we do that, you can't buy forms in 18-foot lengths, but you could buy a 20-foot board. You can buy a 16-foot board. My question for you, though, is an 18 and a 16-foot exactly what you need? And I want you to think about how you would nail these things together. If you have an 18-foot board and a 16-foot board, you're going to end up with this gap in the corner. So there's nothing to nail into on either side. So one of these edges has to be longer by an inch and a half on this side and an inch and a half on this side. So 18-foot 3 inches would work, because that would overlap the outside edge of this 16-foot board. So keep that in mind as you're planning your design. If that doesn't quite make sense, call me over and I can give you another visual to help you out with that. So when you're doing a cost estimate, you're going to have a forecast of the cost of the future program. That is the cost estimate. So you prepare these at different levels of the project. There's the conceptual design, when you have kind of a rough idea of what you're trying to do. Then you have just a rough overall cost. This is something that we want to consider to bid on. Then you have your construction documents. When it's about 90% completed, all of your documents are 90% completed, you can do a lot more accurate bid. And that gives you, again, just an updated cost. Then finally, your bid phase, where you submit a bid to the person who's going to hire you, or maybe it's the city, if you're going to do a project for the city, or the state, whatever it is, they're going to get multiple different bids from a lot of different contractors, and they're going to choose one that usually is less expensive, but also offers a lot of the things that they're looking for. So they may have a better plan, a little bit more cost, but a better plan, they might get selected. But usually cost is a big factor in this. So that's the bid phase. And these are going to include things like quantity takeoff, quotes, costs, material costs, labor costs. All of these things are a part of the bid. And this usually is completed with a cost estimating software. It's also usually one of the first things that a new civil engineer will be tasked with, is cost estimating, because it's such a huge part to the industry, is being able to accurately do costs. So if you're ever an intern for civil engineering, usually one of the first things that they'll have you do is take a look at cost estimates. So the cost estimator specializes in developing cost information. That most of them are employed in construction industry, if you're a cost estimator, and you gain experience through working in the construction industry. So once you've done it a lot, you just get faster at it, you get better at it, because you know exactly, costs of materials and things like that. And these are usually employed by the owners, project managers, construction contractors. We'll have cost estimators actually employed to help them figure out total cost of projects. So these are all the things that we took a look at today. Make sure you have those in your notes so that you're ready to use them for the end of the unit quiz and for the assignments that you have coming up. That's it.